الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تبارك وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. نسأل الله العزيز الغفار أن يجيرنا وإياكم من عذاب النار. We're still out with our series pertaining to the methodology of the people of Sunnah and Jama. And in case you've heard this terminology for the first time, this terminology or these words were uttered by the Prophet ﷺ when he was asked many times about, and when he mentioned the different groups that the Jews split into, and then the groups that the Christians split into, and then he mentioned that the Ummah of Muhammad, the Muslims, were split into 73 groups, and he was asked which one is upon the truth. He said, the ones that follow my Sunnah, my way, my path, my tradition, and the ones that are with Al-Jama'ah, they stay with the group of the Muslims. So these words are not strange, they come straight from the mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as I told you before, the purpose of this series is for us to know who's who, for us to know who we are. Are we on the straight path? Are we on the path that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam traced for us? Are we on the correct methodology? Because as he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam predicted, as he foretold, this ummah did split into 73 groups or sects or different schools of thoughts or methodologies, or you call it whatever you will, and they all claim to have the truth. They all claim to be the ones. And how do we know who's who? How do we make a difference between the ones that are for real and the ones that are fake? We go straight to the scholars, the real scholars of Islam, the ones that follow the true path of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As I told you, this is the purpose of this series. We left it last Friday in talking about a Sahabi, a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had, vision. Someone who asked about something that the majority of the others didn't ask about. And that Sahabi is Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman. يعني تركناكم في الأسبوع الماضي ونحن نتحدث عن حديث حذيفة بن اليمان ذلك الصحابي الجليل الذي كانت له رؤيا كان بعيد النظر وكان يسأل عن غير الذي ائتلف عليه كان يسأل عن غير الذي كان باقي الصحابة يسألون عنه ألا وهو الشر فقال رضي الله عنه This is the hadith collected by Bukhari by the authority of حذيفة himself the hadith of Bukhari قال حذيفة رضي الله عنه كان الناس يسألون النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان الناس يسألون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الخير وكنت أسأله عن الشر مخافة أن يدركني the people used to ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم about good things about good and when he says about what is good meaning what can we do to get closer to Allah what is the path of Jannah what good deeds should I do to get closer to Allah Oh, Prophet of Allah, advise me about this, advise me about that. This is, in general, what the Sahaba used to ask about. And by the way, you should know that the Sahaba were not authorized to always keep asking the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam questions. You will find that in the Quran. That is why they used to love when a Bedouin someone from outside of Medina will come and enter the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ and will ask questions. They used to love that, they enjoy that because it's an opportunity for them to learn. That's why you'll find in the Quran, and based on what's in the Quran, the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ asked only 13 questions in total. That's where you find in the Quran, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ and they ask you about. And this phrase that they asked you about, يسألوا ويسألونك, you'll find the only 13 times throughout the whole Quran. صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أمروا ألا يكثروا على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الأسئلة. لذلك نجد أن مجموع الأسئلة التي سألوها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هي 13 وهي التي تجدونها في كتاب الله ويسألونك عن المحيض ويسألونك عن الخمر والميسر ويسألونك ماذا ينفقون You'll find these questions that start with ويسألونك and they ask you about and they ask you about women's menses they ask you about what is the ruling on gambling and alcohol What is the ruling on? What should they spend? How should they spend their money? Who should they spend it on? And so on and so forth. 13 questions in total. So, Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu. And this is probably, this took place probably before the ruling came down that the Sahaba should refrain from asking too many questions. Because the Prophet Sallallahu came to deliver the message and he would. And he will, and he has delivered the message without them having to ask everything that they needed to know about the life of this world and about the hereafter. He told them, and I refer you to an important hadith. He said that subhanAllah, and this hadith was narrated by many of the Sahaba. Said that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoke to us one day after Salatul Fajr. He prayed Fajr. He got up on the minbar and he started speaking to the Sahaba. And then there is nothing that we need to know about the life of this world or about the hereafter except that he told us about it. And this went on all day. The Prophet ﷺ would speak to them after Fajr until Dhuhr. He'll get down from the minbar, they'll pray Dhuhr, he gets back up and he speaks to them. When Asr time comes, he gets down, they pray, he gets back up until Maghrib. After Maghrib, he gets back up on the minbar, speaks to them until Isha. He spoke to them about everything they need to know. And he said, you and your memory, subhanAllah. حفظ من حفظه ونسي ونسي من نسيه. And the ones that had short memory were able to memorize about everything that he said. And the ones that did not, they were out of luck. But the Prophet ﷺ delivered the message. So Hudhayfa said that the people used to ask the Prophet ﷺ about the good things, and I asked him about evil things, being afraid that those evil things will come to me, will happen to me. To be able to avoid them, I need to know them to be able to avoid them. Subhanallah. فقلت قال حذيفة رضي الله عنه فقلت يا رسول الله إنا كنا في جاهلية وشر. By the way, this hadith I gave last week, but I just wanna start with it. He said, يا رسول الله, we were in جاهلية, we were in ignorance and evil. وأتوقف عند هذه الكلمة كلمة جاهلية. فلما يسمع الناس أن العرب قبل الإسلام كانوا في جاهلية يظنون أنهم كانوا أوباشا وأنهم ما كانت عندهم مروءة وما كانت عندهم أخلاق وإلى غير ذلك من الكلام الباطل الذي نسمع. When you hear the word جاهلية, you'll think automatically that the Arabs before the Prophet ﷺ lived in absolute ignorance, and they were people that had no morality, they were people that were savages, and they were bloodthirsty, and so on and so forth. But nothing can be further from the truth. Hadith is sahih. These people were chosen by Allah Ta'ala to carry the torch of Islam, of this final message sent to mankind, for a reason. Allah Ta'ala is wise in His choices, isn't He? أحكم الحاكمين. Allah Ta'ala is the wisest. And He, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, يخلق ما يشاء ويختار. He's the one that creates what He wills, and He's the one that chooses. He chose the Arabs for this most important message, to carry the flag of the last revelation sent to mankind, because they had some traits of character. The very first thing, they had courage. They were people of honor and they had courage. Their courage was misguided somewhat, needed to be channeled in the right direction, but they had courage. The era of al-Jahiliyyah, the time before the Prophet he would die for any cause. He will die for the cause of his tribe, for the honor of his tribe. He will die to protect his family or a tribe member. They have no problem with that. You know, they will give their life willingly, gladly, no problem whatsoever. And they will give everything that they have for a cause that they believe in. They will give all of their money, for a cause they believed in. I mean, they were generous. They were excessively generous. So much so that they will give all of their wealth, and they will give themselves as well for a cause they believed in. All you had to do is give them the correct cause, the right cause. They were people of morality and nobility. And I told you the story many times before, and I refer you back to that story, the story of our great-great-great-grandmother Hajar, and I happen to have named one of my daughters after her, Hajar, the wife of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And subhanAllah, the Prophet with Ibrahim alayhi salam brought Hajar and Ismail as a baby, and he left them there by themselves, in the middle of nowhere, in the place that was supposed to be Mecca. And subhanAllah reminds me of how beautiful the Qur'an, how precise the Qur'an is. The same story, almost the same story, and the same dua is mentioned twice in the Qur'an. The dua after Ibrahim alayhi salam leaves Hajar and Ismail, and he walks away. When he goes around the corner where no one can see him, he made dua to Allah. You find a dua in Surah Al-Baqarah. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا وَارْزُقْ أَهْلَهُ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ مَنْ آمَنَ مِنْهُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Oh Allah, make this safe and secure بلد, city. And he said in the Arabic language, when you mention a name without the alif and lam, it's called nakira. فَقَالَ بَلَدًا آمِنًا فَقَالَ نَكِرًا. He did not use the alif and lam. Alif and lam in Arabic is the equivalent of the. So he mentioned it as a city. بَلَدْ آمِنًا. Why? Because there was nothing yet there. There was nothing. There was nothing built yet. So he used the word the word for city and without alif and lam, precision. وَرْزُقْ أَهْلَهُ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ مَنْ آمَنَ مِنْهُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. And give its people. Were there any people there? There was nobody there. But he said, give its people, meaning the potential people that will live here, مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ, from the fruits, meaning give them sustenance. Especially the ones that believe in you and believe in the last day. So basically, oh Allah, make this city that's not existing yet. That's why I'm using it in Nakira. I'm not using the article the for it. That city that will come after me. Make it safe and secure. And give its potential dwellers sustenance, especially the ones that believe in you and the last day. Why? So Allah, the Prophet Ibrahim is making a dua for Allah Ta'ala to create a city there and then give them economy. Allow them for them to exist. They need to have sustenance. Then you find almost the same dua in Surah Ibrahim. What is it, chapter 14 or 15? One of them, Surah Ibrahim. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا وَجُنُوبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ نَعْبُدُ الْأَصْنَامَ. Ya Allah. He's uttering the same dua almost, but he said this time he used alif and lam. Because now the city exists. هناك بلد. فقال هذا البلد. ليس بل هذا بلدا. هذا البلد. He used the article المعرفة. I mean, this city existed. But did he ask for sustenance this time? He said, وَجْنُوبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ أَنَّعْبُدُ الْأَصْنَامِ. And prevent me and my offsprings from what? From worshipping the idols. You see, he asked for a city to be created, for sustenance to be given to them. Now that is done, he's making dua for that city to be safe and secure, the city that exists now, and he is making supplication for the very most important thing for them to have is what? What is that? At-Tawheed, the oneness, monotheism. Oh Allah, prevent me and prevent my offspring, meaning his Ismail and his offspring, the offspring that lives in this city, my offspring that lives in this city, prevent them from falling into a shirk, and make them people of Tawheed. Make them people that worship you alone without ascribing any partners with you. You see the precision of the Quran, subhanAllah. So, Hudhayfa said that, subhanAllah, we were in Jahiliyyah. Going back to the item that I was talking about the Jahiliyyah, why did I get to the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam? Is when he left Hajar and Ismail, Allah Ta'ala responded to the supplication of Ibrahim right away. And it's in the form of the tribe of Zuhum. They saw birds flying after the incident with Zamzam. Ismail started kicking with his feet. The angel Jibreel Gabriel came and with his wing he dug, and the well of Zamzam gushed forth. And immediately birds started flying over. They found water, and the tribe of Zuhum noticed the birds, knew it as an indication for water, and they went there. Now this is my point, the point that I'm getting to. This is a tribe of hundreds, maybe thousands of people. And they are warriors because they live in the desert. They have weapons. They can fight. They can defend themselves. They come and they find a woman with a baby and water. The easiest thing in the world, something that you'll find everywhere else, especially in Europe. Europe was a jungle for the longest time. The strongest will win. They will say, move out of the way, woman. This is our water. Makes sense, right, Todd? Makes sense, right? But they said, do we have permission to live here and to use this water? And we will even pay you for it. So Hazel ended up making a living out of that water. They did not deprive her of anything. That's how Ismail came to live in Mecca and his offspring until Muhammad was born in Mecca, because he's from the offspring of Ismail. That is why Muhammad by origin is not an Arab. He became an Arab because of Ismail. That's why we have difference. Three types of Arab, as I told you before. Al-Arab al-Ba'idah, the Arabs, the ancient Arabs that don't exist anymore. And those are the people of Hud. And Hud was the very first Arab prophet. And incidentally, I named one of my boys after this prophet, Hud, alayhi salam. He was the very first Arab prophet. And those were Al-Arab al-Ba'idah, the Arabs that disappeared. And then there's Al-Arab al-Aribah. Al-Arab al-Aribah are these tribes, tribe of Zurhum, tribe of Khuza'ah, and so on and so forth. They used to live in Yemen. And because of the dam of Ma'rib was destroyed, and they lost all of their crops and their livestock, they became nomadic tribes, and they spread everywhere in the Arabic Peninsula. Hope I'm not confusing you with too much information. But just focus with me, inshallah ta'ala. These Arabs became Al-Arab Al-Aribah, the current Arabs, the real Arabs. Now with Ismail being from the offspring of Ibrahim, Ibrahim is from where? Falluj. Ibrahim al-Falluj. Walla Qarim al-Falluj. Alayhi salam. Minin? Hayo. He knows. Close to his neighbor. Ibrahim is almost his neighbor. He's from Iraq. That's where Ibrahim was from. Did not speak Arabic. So therefore, his offspring are of the same descendants. But because Ismail lived with Jurhum in Mecca, he learned the Arabic language. It became his language. Therefore became the third kind of Arabs, Al-Arab Al-Musta'ariba. That's what they're called, the new Arabs, subhanAllah. So this is a side note there. So when this shows that these people had nobility. Instead of just telling the woman to move out of the way, they just offered to share the water with her and to even pay her for that water. So that is why you find that the Prophet said, قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, إننا بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق. Verily, certainly, without a doubt, I have been sent to perfect morality. And he did not say, I was sent to teach morality, because morality already existed. I'm just going to perfect it. So, which means the Arabs, they call them Jahiliyyah. Why? Why do they call them Jahiliyyah? People of ignorance. Who can tell me? لماذا سموا بالعربي جاهلية؟ لماذا؟ من يجيب؟ Who can answer me? Why would they call? Jahiliyyah في العقيدة. Because their ignorance, jazakallah khair, their ignorance was ignorance of creed. It was a problem of creed. They did not have monotheism, and that is the worst ignorance on the face of the earth. The type of ignorance that will land someone in Jahannam. So this is the one ignorance that you have to avoid at all costs. So Hudhayfa said, we were in a jahiliyyah, we were in ignorance of aqidah and shar, an evil, subhanAllah. فَجَاءَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا الْخَيْرِ. And Allah Ta'ala brought us this tremendous bounty, this goodness, which is al-Islam, al-Tawheed, monotheism. فَهَلْ بَعْدَ هَذَا الْخَيْرِ مِنْ شَرْ. So he's asking the question. So is there any evil coming our way after this good thing that happened to us, that is Islam? قال نعم. The Prophet ﷺ said yes. قلت وهل بعد ذلك الشر من خير. He said, I said, is there any good coming after this evil? The Prophet ﷺ said, نعم. The Prophet ﷺ said yes. قال نعم. He said, yes, there is good after this evil, but there is a dafan in it. Dafan, as I explained last time, it is something that spoils it. Something that's like, it's good, but it has a little evil in it. Huh? It has a little evil. Just like when a metal is not pure, well, gold is not pure. You have gold and you have other metals that are mixed with it, and you have to separate them. Same kind of thing. Fihi dafan. Qultu. So Hudayfa is being precise. قلت وما دفنه. What is this little evil that is associated with it, that comes with it? قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet said, قوم يهدون بغير هدي تعرف منهم وتنكر. A people that guide, quote unquote, guide, meaning they misguide, with a guidance that's in their mind, it's a guidance, but it's not my guidance. Meaning that they think they're guiding people to the truth, but they, in reality, they're misguiding them, subhanAllah. And today, more than any time before, we see people like that, subhanAllah. تَعْرِفُ مِنْهُمْ وَتُنْكِرُ. That means you will recognize that evil, that falsehood that they're upon, and you will be, your heart will reject it. You will be able to reject it because you recognize it. تعرف منهم وتنكر. قلت فهل بعد ذلك الخير من شر. I said, Hudayfa is talking, is there any evil after this good that you're talking about? قال صلى الله عليه وسلم دعاة على أبواب جهنم من أجابهم إليها قذفوه فيها. Callers at the gate of Jahannam. And they're standing at the gate of Jahannam and they're calling people. Whoever answers them, they will throw him in Jahannam. And like I told you last time, more than ever, today, these kind of people that the Prophet ﷺ warned about are not by the thousands, they're by the millions. I wanted to mention this in the next khutbah, but I will mention it to you. Who from the people that are Arabs here is familiar with a cartoon channel by the name of NBC3? Yeah, I know that you. I knew that you would. I knew that you would. NBC3. Taraf NBC3? Tabi' al-cartoon? You should know that the majority of the series, the cartoons that this channel brings, are full of shirk. Full of a shirk. But in particular, there's a series that they have now, a new series, by the name of the 99 Heroes. Al-Abtal al-99. Ta'afim? The 99 Heroes. They get this number 99. This is a cartoon with 99 different characters. Each one of them, brace yourself now, each one of them carries one of the names and attributes of Allah. You have one character named Jalil. One character is named Samad. One is named Qahir. One, and so on and so forth. Imagine this. And they're talking to each other and they call each other these names. Are you guys? And the one that did this is a Muslim, so-called Muslim from Kuwait. Du'atun ala babi Jahannam. Callers at the gate of Jahannam. They're bringing people, they're poisoning the minds of the kids. This is a channel that every Arabic speaking Muslim receives in his house. He watches this. 99 characters each one of them carrying يعني what are the names and attributes of Allah. هذا الكرتون هذا اللي أتكلم عنه. الأبطال التسعة والتسعين فيه يعني شخصيات 99 شخصية كل شخصية تحمل اسما من أسماء الله الحسنى. تخيل هذا الأمر، واحد اسمه القاهر، واحد اسمه الصمد، واحد اسمه الجليل. Can you imagine this craziness? This is what's happening in this ummah. These du'a, these scholars, they were hiding before in the time where Islam, when the time was, when Islam was in its position, a rightful position of honor, these people, these types of people were hiding like rats. But today, they're out full force and they're proud of what they do. So if you happen to have this channel, NBC3, beware, because it's very dangerous. Before you know it, because you have to understand, the majority of those things are subliminal. The most dangerous things in cartoons is subliminal messages. And, hola, ¿cómo estás? Bienvenido. Mashallah. Brother just came back from Mexico. Mashallah. Alhamdulillah, salam. So, subhanAllah, يعني, these are the types of people that we're talking about. They want to start from the ground so that the next generation that will be the ones, the new Muslims, the ones that carry the flag of Islam in 15, 20 years, they'll have issues with their tawheed. They'll have problems with their tawheed. This is what these people are trying to do. Du'atun ala babi jahannam. أجابهم إليها قذفوه فيها. Whoever answers their call, they'll throw him in جهنم. نعوذ بالله من ذلك. حذيفة does not stop there and he wants more information. قال قلت يا رسول الله صفهم لنا. Oh Messenger of Allah, describe these people to us. قال هم من جلدتنا ويتكلمون بألسنتنا. They are from our skin, and they are from our race. This guy that I just told you about, that is calling characters, giving them the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where is he from? Kuwait. That's the Arabic peninsula. That's the peninsula of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's not from somewhere far. Huh? Supposed to be a Muslim, but yet he did this, subhanAllah. So they are from our skin. And they speak our language. هم من جلدتنا وتكلمون بألسنتنا. قلت, he said, يا رسول الله ومسجر فالله فما تأمرني إن أدرك لي ذلك. What would you advise me if that happens to me? If that happens in my lifetime. If I happen to see this, if I witness this crazy nonsense, what do I do? قال صلى الله عليه وسلم تلزم جماعة المسلمين وإمامهم. You stick to the jama'ah. That select group of people that are holding on to my sunnah, the ones that are keeping these things away from them, from themselves, and their imam. That's what you do. And that's what we're all supposed to do, wallahi. We stick together in the masjid. We try to avoid these things that will poison. You have no idea how many horror stories I hear. You know, as an imam, you get people that come and ask you, Imam, I have this issue with my children, I have this issue with my wife. If I was to share with you, these are people's problems and secrets and I can't share them with anybody, but if I was to share with you some of the things that I hear, wallahi, I go home sometimes sick in my stomach. I go home with my heart burning, literally. I feel a pain from the things that I hear. What the things that are happening to our sons and our daughters, it will shock you to your core. All of that because of this, because of the poison of TV, because of the kids being able to have the remote and they can surf as they want and see whatever they want, and they're being poisoned subliminally and all of this, all of a sudden when they become of age and they are able to revolt, they can, and they're able to commit mutiny, and then subhanAllah you start seeing the result of that. We have to protect ourselves. We have to protect our kids from these things because they are real and they're dangerous. And if we don't pay attention to them, we will be filled with sorrow. We will be filled with regret if we don't handle this properly, subhanAllah. So stick to Jama'ah, means stick to being in the masjid, subhanAllah. Learn your deen to be able to protect yourself and to protect your kids. قلت حذيفة يتكلم فإن لم يكن لهم جماعة ولا إمام. What if there's no جماعة and there's no إمام? What do I do? Listen to this. قال فاعتزل تلك الفرق كلها ولو أن تعض على أصل شجرة أو بأصل شجرة حتى يدركك الموت وأنت على ذلك. This shows the gravity of the situation. This statement by the Prophet ﷺ shows us how dangerous the situation is. The gravity of the situation. He said, if there is no jama'ah and there is no imam, even if you have to go and bite the trunk of a tree. Can you imagine yourself biting the trunk of a tree? Huh? Do we even have mouths that are big enough? It's impossible, but this is a metaphor. The Prophet ﷺ said, al-majazi, he's now telling you, even if you have to do that, bite the trunk of a tree and stay like that until you die, it's better for you than getting involved in this nonsense and finding yourself in Jahannam. Does it make sense? Because we live the life of this world. And subhanAllah, because of many factors, a lot of times we get blinded to other things. And to us, this is what is real. This is our life. This is what we have to work hard for. This is what we have to take care of. And a lot of times that blinds us to the real life. The real life is not here. This is temporary. The real life is somewhere else. Either a lot better or a lot worse. And it all depends on what we do here. Remember that, subhanAllah, a lot of times you get good advice from other sources than Muslim sources. I stumbled upon this. He looks like a young progressive preacher giving a speech to a large audience, and he said, "Look at this rope here. This rope. Imagine that this rope goes for eternity. It never stops. It just keeps going. And this part, this small part here, this red part here, it's only from here to here. You see, it begins here and it ends right here. And the rest of it goes for eternity." He said, "What this rope is our existence. From the day that Allah Ta'ala created us, it's our existence. The red part is the life of this world. See, you see the beginning, you see the end. It's very short. The rest of it is the rest of our existence. But subhanAllah, it could be either in paradise or in the hellfire. So we spend so much time and effort taking care of this part here. We see the beginning of it, we see the end of it, and so quickly, and we neglect to take care of the rest of it that goes on for eternity." When you think about it, it's absolute foolishness. A person that deals with his existence that way is someone who is foolish. Someone, subhanAllah, that needs to reconsider. He's someone that is not responsible. But isn't that the majority? Isn't that all of us? Because it is in our core to only believe in that which we can see and touch and smell, tangible things that are not tangible. It's okay. I'll worry about it later. That's why Allah Ta'ala praised, as I told you before, Surah Al-Baqarah. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ أَلِفْ لَا مِنْ ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا غَيْبَ فِيهِ. That is the book in which there is no doubt. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It is a guidance for the pious ones. Then Allah says, answer the question, you hear the pious ones, who are they, O Allah? Who are these muttaqeen? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. The ones that believe in the unseen. Believing in the unseen is crucial, ya ikhwan. It is absolutely crucial. If we don't truly believe in the unseen, then we got ourselves a problem. The ones that lose sight of the unseen are the ones that go astray. And this idea of the unseen, we really have to program it in the minds of our kids, because they can lose sight of it very quickly. If I don't believe in the unseen, then there is no accountability. There's nothing that waits for me on the other side. Then I'll just live my life and enjoy my life and go and party and drink and take drugs and do everything that I want. Isn't that what everyone is doing? Huh? Peer pressure? Isn't that what everyone is doing? That's what everyone is doing. Why should I be different? Why should I stand out? Why shouldn't I blend in with everybody else? SubhanAllah. And then a lot of them, they don't wake up. When they wake up, it's too late. They're addicted to something. They're sick. They're beyond recovery. They're beyond recovery. Why? Because we did not instill in them. Remember, Allah is with you at all times. He's looking at you. He sees what you do. And He will hold you accountable. Make no mistake about it. He will hold you accountable for every single thing that you do. أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ وَنَسُوهُ. Allah Ta'ala, Allah holds account of it. Everything. And they forget. Do you remember what he did? Do you remember what he did 2 days ago, 3 days ago? Most of us don't. But Allah Ta'ala not only remembers it, but He has hafadah. He has angels that write every single thing. Allah Azza wa Jalla قال إِنَّمَا نَعُدُّ لَهُمْ عَدًّا. We are holding account with precision of every single thing that they do. Our kids, we can't be with them all the time. So they have to know that they have to have the muraqabah of Allah, that Allah looks at them. And they have to learn to be bashful of Allah. Before I do something, Allah is looking at me. How can I do something wrong while Allah is looking at me? And this is what makes a difference between us and those first 3 centuries that the Prophet ﷺ praised. Because even their children had the muraqabah of Allah. Before they do anything, they say, they ask themselves, would Allah be pleased with this? Would Allah be displeased? Before they say a word, they think about it. If I say this word, would Allah be pleased with me? Or would He be angry with me? You know what? I better be quiet. Abu Hurairah said, Allah gave you 2 ears and a mouth because He wants you just to listen more than you talk. Don't talk too much, just listen. That's why you're given 2 ears and a mouth. It was said that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would put a rock in his mouth. They asked him, Abu Bakr, what are you doing? Put a rock in your mouth? What do you think you're doing? I said, I examined what my tongue does, you know, the speaking. When I talk, I just looked at it. And I found that everything, about everything that I'm going to say, this is Abu Bakr. Huh? The closest companion of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the one that was with him from the beginning, the one that migrated with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, I found that everything that I could possibly say would only take me to the other side, would only make Allah angry with me. So I put a rock in my mouth so I don't speak. So he was a man of a few words. But subhanAllah, we live in a time where people, they talk more than they listen. Why? Because I am the one, I know, you're not going to tell me, you're not going to teach me. What are you doing? Ikhwa, this is what I do for a living, being an imam and a da'iyah. This is why I study, right? I meet people that I know just a few months ago, they know nothing about religion. But Allah gave them some guidance, and they they're on their way back. They're in rehab, let's say. They're on their way back to repentance. But subhanAllah, because of some importance that they were given in Jahiliyyah before coming back to Islam, they want that spotlight and that importance to be given to them in Islam as well. So what happens? When they discuss any issue with you, it has to do with Islam, they're the ones that do the talking. And they want me, or anybody else that has knowledge, to be quiet and to listen. And that's a big problem. Problem of ego, problem of pride. People, even when they are guided back, the shaitan finds a way to lead them astray. SubhanAllah. The biggest enemy of knowledge is what? Two things. Arrogance and bashfulness. You're too bashful to ask the right question, and you're arrogant. You don't want to hear. You're not going to tell me. I know. How do you know? Because I know. And these, they fall into this category. There's so many of them, they come on TV because they read a book or two, listened to a few tapes, a few videos. It reminds me of that sentence that I shared with you before of Sheikh Abu Bakr al-Zayri, rahimahullah, one of the big scholars that spent years, countless years teaching in Medina. He had this nice accent, he's from Algeria originally. So واحد يقول له كتابين واسمع له شريطين ويقول لك احنا مع ابن عثيمين. There's a big scholar by the name of Ibn Uthaymeen. He says, he makes it rhyme. He said, what? This person that reads a couple of books, he listens to a couple of tapes, and he says, I am the likes of Ibn Uthaymeen. I am just like that big scholar. One of the biggest scholars of our era. This is the mentality. SubhanAllah. You're not going to tell me. I know already. How do you know? Did you take the time to study and learn? I just know because this is me. SubhanAllah. People become enemies of themselves. So the Prophet ﷺ said, even if you have to do something unthinkable, bite the trunk of a tree until death comes to you, is way better for you than losing your akhirah. Losing your hereafter and finding yourself in the hellfire. And subhanAllah, ma'rifatu bilhaqti min al-batil min aham min ni'am. Knowing truth from falsehood is one of the most important bounties that Allah can give to someone, subhanAllah. SubhanAllah, la ما فعل الناس الشر وهم يحسبون أو يحسبون يحسبون ورش يحسبون حفص أنهم على صراط المستقيم. Many times you find people that do deeds and they think they are upon the absolute truth while they are completely misguided. Incidentally, there's actually someone running for office who's like that. Right? He thinks that, he praises himself day and night. I did good, didn't I? He comes out of any event and people say, man, did you hear that? Did you hear this nonsense that he was saying? Everyone says that, everyone that is educated. But he said, did you see how good I did? Did you see how good I was? Right? SubhanAllah. He's one of those people. Allah Ta'ala said, Surah Al-Kahf. قل هل ننبئكم بالأخسرين أعمالا الذين ضل سعيهم في الحياة الدنيا وهم يحسبون أنهم يحسنون صنعا أولئك الذين كفروا بآيات ربهم ولقائه فحبطت أعمالهم فلا نقيم لهم يوم القيامة وزنا. Allah Ta'ala says, say, shouldn't we, this is the we of majesty, the we of Allah, the divine we, the plural of majesty, shouldn't we reveal to you about the ones that lose in every respect when it comes to their deeds? They do deeds, they have work, they put in effort, but they come to Allah and they find that everything that they did was what? Null and void. أَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالَ. They lose all of their deeds. Who are they, Ya Allah? الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ. Their daily affairs, their daily deeds, the things that they do, they are misguided in it. ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ. SubhanAllah. فِي الْحَيَةِ الدُّنْيَا. Everything that they do in the life of this world, they are misguided. Why what? Well, they think that they are doing the best of deeds. SubhanAllah. And wallahi, we see those people on a daily basis. The woman that you see in the street, that is almost, she's almost without any clothes. And she's all proud of it. And if you tell her something about it, she'll tell you, I'm a decent woman. This is how I dress. This is me. This is my freedom. Huh? I am free. La habib, you're not free. You are not free. We were born, we were made as slaves and servants of Allah Ta'ala. There's no freedom there. Look in the Quran. See if you can find the word free. Look for this word in the Quran. You will not find it. There's no free. Huh? If you think you're free, then you get a free ride. There's no free ride. You're going to live as a slave and die as a slave. You better act as a good slave. Be a good slave. Be a good boy. Be a good slave. And Allah Ta'ala will make sure that you're free in the Jannah. But be a bad slave, and Allah Ta'ala will make sure that you will be in shackles in Jahannam. Then you will taste. You will see what the freedom is like. SubhanAllah. The ones that come to Allah with their deeds are not void. Well, they think that they did the worst possible. Reminds me of back in the early 90s, I had a sales job. Doesn't matter, you know, but it was a sales job. And there was a person next to me. He had a client. And this guy's English was so broken. It was painful to listen to. You know, 300 times he says, you know, like. And he's trying to sell to these people whatever product. And he's going back and forth, and I couldn't understand anything he said. But I think it felt so sorry for him that they bought what he was selling. So I'm sitting there thinking to myself, man, that was painful. This was horrible. I feel sorry for this guy. Then he turns to me and says, hey, did you see that? That was smooth, right? He said, that was smooth, right? I said, yeah. I guess. SubhanAllah. This is a small example of these people. They do everything wrong, but they think that, mashallah, they killed it, they nailed it. They're the ones. Huh? SubhanAllah. What is the result of this, SubhanAllah? What is the result? Ula'ika, those are the ones that disbelieve in the ayat and the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the kufr comes in many forms. Huh? Kufr doesn't have to be the disbelief, not believing in Allah. But you can disbelieve in some signs of Allah. Just like, for example, the Muslim women that go out there wearing the same thing that non-Muslims wear. Shorts and mini skirts and things like that. And you tell them, you're a Muslim. It is forbidden for a Muslim to be dressed like this. She'll tell you, no. The pillars of Islam are five, and hijab is not one of them. I follow the five pillars. The rest of that don't come tell me anything. What is that? She is. This is a kufr.
Allah Ta'ala said to do something, His Messenger said to do something, she's saying this doesn't exist. This is a form of kufr. According to some scholars, it could be counted as the big kufr. But according to the majority, this is a smaller kufr. This is a big subject, but this is a form of kufr. SubhanAllah. أَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. You believe Allah Ta'ala said that to the Israelites, Banu Israel, but we end up imitating them. Do you believe in some of the book and disbelieve in some others? You cherry pick, pick and choose, whatever suits you, that's what you follow. Whatever, I don't like it that much. Let's brush it to the side. I didn't see it. I don't think it exists. SubhanAllah. This is the way. This is the ones that Allah Ta'ala is talking about. What happens to them? They're the ones that disbelieve in the ayat, in the signs of Allah, in the verses of Allah. And they disbelieve in the meaning of Allah, وَلِقَائِهِ. يعني would you, in your right mind, if you know for a fact that you will meet Allah, and Allah will hold you accountable for the deeds that you do, that you put forth, would you be still playing around like this? People do that. The hereafter. Yeah, the hereafter. It's not really that tangible. Maybe it will happen, maybe. They have doubt. You could not possibly believe in the hereafter with all of your heart and be doing these things unless you have doubts. Maybe it will happen, maybe it will not. Maybe these are just stories that they're telling us to make us afraid. SubhanAllah. They disbelieve in the ayah, the signs of Allah, and they disbelieve in the meaning of Allah. They have doubts about the meaning of Allah. What happens to them? فَحَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ. Their deeds are rendered null and void because of that, subhanAllah. That's why, because of shirk, someone can have his deeds be null and void. Types of kufr. Any type of kufr, a person could have his deeds null and void. SubhanAllah. We have to be very careful with these things. A person's deeds can very easily be rendered null and void. It could be very good. A woman, like for example, I mentioned a woman that does not wear hijab. She could be very good in her salah. She is steadfast. But SubhanAllah, she carries her sin with her for everyone to see. Al-Mujahara bin Ma'siyah. The Prophet ﷺ said, my ummah will be fine, will be just fine, will be in good shape as long as they don't make their sins public. Madam Yujahil, as long as they don't make their sins public. The woman that leaves her house not dressed properly according to what the Prophet ﷺ, the guidelines that he gave, she is Mujahil. She is someone that carries her sin publicly, openly for everyone to see. And this is a very dangerous thing. She will not be alright. The Prophet said, my ummah will be alright, they will be in good shape, as long as they don't make their sins public. The woman, and I'm not harping on women today, but I'm just giving this example. As a result of this, and by the way, fasad al-aqidah, a false creed, a creed that is erroneous, a creed that is warped, can be the reason for a person's deed to be nullified. We have to be very careful with all of these things. فَحَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ. Their deeds were rendered null and void. فَلَا نُقِيمُ لَهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَزْنًا. We will, and when it comes to the scales, and this could be, the explanation of this is many. We will not even put their deeds on a scale. That's one explanation. Or they will have no weight in the eyes of Allah on their reckoning. None whatsoever. And you have to understand, we refer to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ said, Ya Adam, O Adam, Adam said, Labbayk wa sa'dayk. This is the proper way of responding to Allah. He says, get up and take from your sons, from your children, from your offsprings, the ones that will go to Jahannam. The ones that will go to Jahannam. Then the Prophet ﷺ tells the Sahaba that Adam alayhi salam will choose from every 1,000, 999. they go to the hellfire, and one goes to a Jannah.
Scary numbers.
The Sahaba got scared. A lot more than us. Say, Ya Rasulullah, out of every 1,999 will go to Jahannam, and one to a Jannah. He said, don't worry. You are in the people of Jahannam, from the people of Jahannam. You're like the white hairs in the fur of the black ox, or just like the black hair in the fur of the white ox. Meaning that in the people of Jahannam, you are few. But what does that tell us? What does that tell us? That the people that did not live upon the Tawheed, and they died upon Kufr or Shirk, they will not even be spoken to. The time of resurrection, they will come and they will be thrown in the hellfire without any accountability, without any weighing. Who attends the weighing? Whose deeds are weighed? The people that lived upon the Tawheed and died upon the Tawheed, they are the ones that qualify for their deeds to be weighed. Allah Ta'ala says, فَلَا نُقِيمُ لَهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَزْنًا. We will hold no scale for them, because there's no reason. They died upon kufr, they died upon shirk. We will not even talk to them. They're thrown in the hellfire, no question asked. The ones that will be questioned, that qualify for the questioning, that qualify for the weighing, are the ones that died upon a tawheed, monotheism. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you and I from the people of a tawheed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us truth as the truth, and allow us to follow it, and show us falsehood as falsehood, and allow us to stay away from it. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make you and I from these people that He mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf, the end of Surah Al-Kahf, the ones that do deeds, but they lose everything. They lose all in respect to their deeds, because they think that they're on the path of the absolute truth, that they're sure of it, while subhanAllah, they are on falsehood. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make you and I from these people. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the ones that when they hear the speech, they follow the best of it. قُلُوا قَوْلِ هَذَا أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَلَكُمْ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَبِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَجَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. تفضل يا أخي.
Quick question regarding this only TV show that you talked about, when you talked about the 99 names. I missed something you said about what they were acting upon. They were questionable things that the characters did.
No, this is a cartoon on one of the most famous cartoon channels, Arabic kind of cartoon channels. It's called NBC3. Everyone in the Arab world knows this one. Most of the kids watch it. They already have many of the series that have shit in them, but they came up, and instantly these series that have shit, they take them from other TVs, from American TV, and others have been translated into Arabic, like Ben 10 and others, like Ben 10. But subhanAllah, this one was made by Muslims, so-called Muslims, and they شفت دكتور محمود هذا اسمعني كويس عشان الأولاد NBC3 بدأوا يعني الرسوم المتحركة. الاسم هو الأبطال 99. نعم حذر. كل شخصية من الشخصيات لها اسم من أسماء الله عز وجل. عياذا بالله تعالى الله عن ذلك علوم كبير. Each one of these, like I said, they carry one of the names or the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ali, Hakim, Qahir, so on and so forth. Each one of them. Samad. There's a character, like a female character with wearing hijab. Her name is Samad. قناة سعودية؟ لا هي مش قناة سعودية يا حبيبي. لا مش قناة سعودية.
كل السعوديات
أبو عبد الله.
أبو عبد الله. هذول القنوات كلها إسرائيلية. ABC كلهم.
بس هي بتبنيها السعودية.
تبنيها مش تبنيها يعني. شوف يا أخي هذا الدليل. الدليل على أن المقيمين القائمين على هذه القناة لا يتقون الله عز وجل. هذا الفساد. They're trying to destroy the creed of the children. I don't know if I answered your question or did I just drive by. These are, they've given characters, cartoon characters, names and attributes that belong to Allah. 99. The Prophet said that Allah has 99 names, 100 minus 1. Whoever holds account of them will enter Al-Jannah. They take these 99 names, they take the article from them, the Alif and Lam, they take it away, to make it not clear, gray, make it kind of gray, and give these characters. And they have superpower because of this rock. They have superpowers. Each one of them has some kind of power. A clear attempt to destroy the creed of the children. SubhanAllah. Any other questions? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, when the ruling came, and Allah Ta'ala told the Sahaba not to make the burden of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam heavy by asking too many questions.
When did the rule come in? End of the life of the Prophet?
No, because if I remember, I don't remember the year, but it was kind of in the middle, because they were asking way too many questions. And the Prophet, that was a burden of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it so that they should not ask any question, and only 13 questions were recorded. The ones that come into Quran, and they ask you about, you'll find them in the 13 questions according to the scholars subhanAllah. This is a whole thing. I don't want to go into the subject, because at first Allah ta'ala told them to, every time you have a question for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bring a salat. Give a charity, and that was difficult for some of them that were poor. That's why they loved when a Bedouin, when an Arabi came to Al-Madinah and he had questions to the Prophet ﷺ, it was an opportunity for them to listen, because they knew they were forbidden from asking too many questions. That's why the scholar talked about these 13 questions that were recorded in the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows this. No space, subhanAllah. Any questions?
What's
that is? Huh? Taqib? Taqib? Yani taqib min al-iqab? Aw al-mu'aqaba? Aw al-ta'aqub? Aw al-isti'qab? Tafadhal.
Lamma?
Ya akhi, raqiq al-mim, ya akhi, Allah yahdik. Lamma? المهم
الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم سئل من اليهود مثل المساكين قال يسألونك عن الجبال الله سبحانه وتعالى قال له خذ 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 لما وصل الى الله سبحانه وتعالى ما قال له خذ يسألونك عني رأسا ما خلى مسافة او مساحة
هذا في القرآن يسألك عني رأسا
قال له اني قريب
نعم في البقرة وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب
قريب أجيب دعوة الداعي
نعم
ما خلى مسافة أو مساحة إنه الإنسان يفكر
نعم إنشال الوساطة ما تقول لهم يا محمد إني قريب نعم صدقت جزاك الله خير الآن ترجم للإخوة الله كذا تعبت والله ترجم He's gonna translate on the time Go ahead Give you a microphone Camera on him. No. He said some questions. Questions were asked to the Prophet Sallallahu about things that are part of the life of this world, like the mountains and such. Allah Ta'ala always said, "Say, Ya Muhammad, say to them, tell them the jibal, the mountains, Allah will destroy completely. But subhanAllah, when the Prophet asked about Allah, he did not say, quote, he did not say, say to the Muhammad, he says, I am directly, to kind of remove that intermediary between the servant and his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they asked, the Prophet, Allah ta'ala said, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي, my servants ask you about me, say I am close by. I answer the supplication for whoever makes it. And then the ayah, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُهُمْ, let them respond to my call and believe in me, perchance they would be guided. SubhanAllah. Very good point, mashallah. So, it's an idea comes straight from the beautiful country of Iraq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala return it to Islam. Any questions? Preguntas de Mexico? I know that coming back from Mexico, you must be fluent right now in Spanish, so, ¿tienes preguntas? No? No hay preguntas? You are lost. Perdido. Khair, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.